Hey, how's it going? This is Chad Haig reporting from Southern India. I'd like to continue the series of videos over Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit. In this eighth lecture, we'll move on to the Observing Reason, and particularly the Observing External Nature section of the book. Now, I apologize for the delay in videos, as to be perfectly honest with you, of the three times or so that I've gone through Phenomenology of Spirit, I always kind of get stuck in this section of the book for a little bit of time. Now, part of the reason for that is it's so long. It's some 53 paragraphs long, and this is only the first of three phases, by the way, as you'll see in this in the course of this lecture. So it's extremely long, but it's also one of those sections of the text that is particularly demanding of your intellect. You have to see how all of those different pieces are fitting together to eventually lead to the light at the end of the tunnel. Now, it is my hope that this lecture will try to make that movement a lot more a lot clearer, a lot easier to understand, and hopefully I'll also make it interesting, because this is a fascinating section of the text, and one which I always really enjoy getting to revisit when I do. So the videos on Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit will, of course, resume, and we will be getting into the rest of the sections of the book in much shorter intervals of time than this last one was. So thank you again for supporting the channel. In paragraph 240, we find that at this point of the phenomenology, consciousness has actually returned to perceiving. But this is not the earlier phase of perception, which we already saw as early as the second phase of the whole book, for that more primitive perception was content to perceive an other which was still understood to be merely external to consciousness. Whereas that earlier perception was passive and receptive with regard to that content, this new perceiving we find within reason is one which is, instead, an active making. Well, an active making of what? Of observations, of course. The kind of thing which reason seeks to observe is not the mere sense contents we saw as early as section 1, nor the thing with properties we found in section 2, but is instead something which has to have the form of notion in itself. In this demand for the object of observation to be universal rather than particular, consciousness is, of course, really just seeking out its own infinitude in the other. Hegel uses a very clever play on words to explain this. Because Sein with a capital S is the word for being in German, and Sein with a little s is the word for his in German, we find that this demand for the being of observation to be notional, we find that that is just another way of saying that Sein, or being, is reasons, or Seinen. In paragraph 241, Hegel affirms that whereas before reason was only dimly aware of its presence within a world of, at that time, lower things, it now instead strides forward to a general appropriation of its assured possessions in order to behold itself as the actual world, as I use Hegel's own phrase. In paragraph 242, we find that this rational observation is also higher than the mere perception we saw in section 2, because whereas the latter was content to deal with particular things with properties, observing reason instead observes nature in order to find laws. Well, what is a law? A law is the universal expressed directly in a particular. Unlike the quest to find the laws of force that we already saw in section 3, which were ultimately laws disconnected from any things, reason now seeks laws as the essence of things directly embodied in them, as a certain notional content embedded within observation itself, rather than something which would only have to be restored symbolically afterwards in an indirect and distantiated manner. Reason will therefore find itself proceed through some three movements, the first of which we will deal with in this video. First, from paragraphs 244 to 297, it will observe organic nature. Then in the second phase, it will seek its own inner workings in logic and psychology, before finally seeking out the unity of spirit and nature, that is, the unity of inner and outer, through the pursuit of physiognomy and phrenology in the third section. Once again, in this video, we will only focus on that first first phase. And that is largely because the section on observing external nature is extremely long, spanning some 53 paragraphs, and is itself to be divided up into the following three phases. First, dealing with particulars, second with organisms, and third with life and environment. Above all, this section revisits the notion of life, which was, of course, discovered as early as section 4, but now views life as symmetrical to reason itself. Both of them, for example, are spontaneous, they're both self-differentiating, they're both universal, etc. In phase 1, beginning with paragraph 244, we find that this declaration that observation is to be the source of truth must not be mistaken for the lower, already failed attempt to just zone in on the sounds, smells, and tastes accessible to the five senses. Reason now sees that that's not real observation, because the determination of such observational content is at least as important as the sensuous apprehension of it. This is because the object of real observation must have the significance of a universal. We are not interested in perceptions that fail that test of universality, such as the mundane particular fact that a penknife lies alongside a snuffbox, to use Hegel's own example. In paragraph 245, he notes that because the universal is defined as that which remains identical with itself, the quest to find universality within observation inevitably takes on the character of a uniform recurrence of the same actions. At this early stage, observation does not yet understand what it observes, but instead has the act of observation itself try to express in a universal way what is actually present only as a single item, to use Hegel's own wording. In other words, although observation describes at this phase, it does not yet grasp the movement within the object under observation, so it instead falls back into the spurious or false infinity of always needing new content. Observation discovers one species only to move on to discovering another, and so on. You might recall that in section 3 on understanding, we saw that false infinity is a series of numbers which never ends. You never actually reach the largest number in that set. But that's not real infinity. True infinity is the self-sameness of a self which differentiates itself but maintains unity. This is, of course, another description of the absolute notion, which observing reason at this stage anyway has once again failed to reach. This section also repeats the first section on sense certainty, for what seems to be an inexhaustible wealth of countless new discoveries open to observation is ultimately revealed to be not an immeasurable wealth, but instead merely the bounds of nature and its own activity, much like the promise of an inexhaustible wealth of content open to sense perception in section 1, which instead turns out to be the most impoverished of all knowledge. In paragraph 246, reason responds to this deadlock by seeking to break out of this infinite loop by sorting out the essential features observed from the accidental or non-essential features observed. Because this, once again, must occur within observation, the essence becomes particular marks through which natural beings distinguish themselves from one another. For example, different types of animals can be distinguished through visible marks such as the unique shapes of their teeth, claws, wings, etc. Nor are these markers meaningful only in the abstract, for they really are the concrete weapons which such animals use to achieve real independence and detachment from the generality, to use Hegel's own words. While animals are relatively well suited to the static observation method of sorting different species into a catalog of types on the basis of their physical features, observation finds that this works much less well for plants and, worst of all, for chemical substances, which are far too unstable to submit to such rigid morphological analysis. They only end up collapsing out of unity when viewed that way. In paragraph 247, Reason, however, soon discovers that the static observation method doesn't really work with 100% success for animals either, because there is movement in nature which disrupts any attempt to preserve a perfectly self-same identity in any one morphological feature. The static features are therefore revealed to be nothing more than phases in a process. In paragraphs 248 to 249, observing reason then finds itself forced to move on from the inner determinateness which merely had the show of permanence when it realizes that what it had been observing was only a set of vanishing moments of a movement, and it is the movement which must be the object of observation. In observing the movement, reason then seeks out the law of movement, but finds in paragraph 250 that this quest to find the law cannot be achieved through merely inferring by analogy that if, for example, one heavy object will fall to the earth if it is dropped from a height, then another heavy object is just as likely to fall to the earth if it is dropped from a height as well. One only arrives at a law in the proper sense of the term if that falling is incorporated into the notion of the heavy body in its relation to the earth, rather than posited on merely probabilistic grounds. By paragraph 251, reason tries to put the law to the test of experiment in order to satisfy the same criterion of observation which had been posited at the beginning of the section, but somehow it only ends up finding that the more it tries to derive the essential law from the sensuous noise which is irrelevant, the more it finds the pure law immersed in empirical material and sensuous being. This attempt to use scientific experimentation to find the pure conditions of law fails ultimately because in experimentation, forces such as electricity inevitably split up into positive and negative forces, rather than maintain the self-same identity which, of course, the universal within intuition was supposed to have. Neither of these positive and negative forces, by the way, ends up being attached to any particular thing at all the more you observe them. Experiment sought to reify the thing in observation by carrying on the methodology of finding the essential marks earlier, those were the claw, the tooth, the wing, etc., but doing that for the purified forces of motion. But the more it tried this, the more it ironically ended up de-thingifying the thing, failing in the process, of course, to absorb it into reason as well. Reason is then forced to move on to the second phase, beginning in paragraph 252, in which it finds, as a result of these failures, that law must instead be the non-sensuous sensuousness, or the incorporeal yet objective being. These are just very strange ways Hegel has of saying that it must be an organism. A rabbit, for example, is not a property or a feature of some other thing. A rabbit directly is the thing itself. A rabbit as an organism is therefore the non-sensuous sensuousness which allows us to move beyond the limitations of the preceding phase. In paragraph 255, reason tries to understand the organism, but does so through submitting animals to the teleological methodology of viewing their features in terms of Lamarckian adaptation. Under this view, reason concludes that, of course, birds must have their wings in order to fly, fish have fins in order to swim, and hairy animals have hair because it's cold where they live and they have to keep themselves warm. Such emphasis on purposeful adaptation in relation to some external telos, of course, ends up falling outside of the notion of the animal and fails to express the underlying essence of the organism at all. As a result of this failure, reason turns inward and views the animal as self-preserving and self-contained life. By paragraph 256, reason now sees that the goal of the organism is not any particular external goal, such as it has wings in order to fly, it has teeth in order to eat, it has claws in order to hunt, etc. For the goal of the organism simply is itself, that is, to preserve its life. It does not produce anything, really, except that life itself. You can find this, for example, in paragraph 257's observation that the organism only leaves itself in order to find itself in the act of returning to itself. For example, the animal goes out seeking food, but in the act of eating what it caught, it re-encounters only itself. As Hegel put it himself, what it arrives at through the process of action is itself. Or more specifically, its life. By paragraph 262-5, the obsession with teleology ends up leading reason to get stuck in the deadlock of recognizing a certain tension between, on the one hand, the real individual, and on the other, the end which eventually becomes so idealized when separated from that individual as to seem to be an ideal end which must have been assigned externally by some other intelligence, such as God, as we find in paragraph 258. By paragraph 262, reason concludes through the kind of picture thinking rather than notional thinking, which it is still stuck at this phase, that the relation between the inner and outer of the organism itself must be a relation of expression. That is to say, the organism has three different powers of expression, the first of them being sensibility, which is the power of self-feeling, or you might say in Hegelian terms, power in itself. The second is the power of irritability, or the power of reactivity to some external stimulus. This is now power for itself. And the third power is the power of reproduction, or the organism's power to relate to the other, to produce another one of itself. This is now power both in itself and for itself. By paragraph 267, we find that each of these powers can be expressed by a physical system. Sensibility is, of course, the inner power expressed by the outer physical nervous system. Irritability is the inner power expressed by the outer physical muscular system. And reproduction is the inner power expressed by the outer physical visceral system. Unfortunately, by paragraph 271, reason finds that although all three of these powers, that is, sensibility, irritability, and reproduction, must be anchored in the same single unified organism, reason finds that any rigorous attempt to formalize the relations among these three distinct powers only results in laws which can only ever take the logical form of empty tautologies. But those are not really laws at all. For example, the pseudo-law that a quantity increases as this quantity increases, which is, of course, only saying the same thing twice. By paragraph 276, we find, worse still, that any attempt to relate the vague notions of the inner powers of sensibility, irritability, and reproduction to the physical structures which are unearthed in anatomy, this fails to unearth the relation between power and anatomy at all. This is for the very serious problem that any numerical symmetry between the number of these powers and the number of anatomical structures quickly collapses, because there are far more anatomical structures than there are inner powers. The more mathematical formalization you apply to this understanding of anatomy, however, the more the body itself devolves to a dead rather than living anatomical structure, in a direct negation of the notion of life which we had posited at the beginning of this section. By paragraph 278, we find that mathematics fails to capture life because the very idea of finding the law of life as we had been pursuing thus far somehow gets lost precisely through perfecting the methodology of scientific law, which is, of course, the methodology of mathematical formalization itself. By paragraph 283, reason then finds that the organism is not just in itself, as it had thought before, rather the organism always is in its environment. Environment is a new notion which allows us to properly describe the relation between inner and outer as ultimately a relation of the inner life to the sum of outer objects with which it interacts in its environment. By phase three, this emphasis on the environment itself allows us to see that the environment also has an inner and an outer. For the environment, the inner is the stream of life, while the outer is the inorganic realm through which that life flows. Interestingly, reason reacts to this discovery of environment by only falling back on another attempt to use numbers to mathematically formalize these now environmental laws of life, this time measuring density through the formula of mass over volume. Reason soon realizes just how silly this is, for density is only one measure of many, another example of the unity we were seeking out collapsing precisely as we seem to perfect the methodology of discovering it. Worse still, measuring gravity is not even one consistent property, for reason finds that the inorganic items in the environment have one gravity number, while the living rabbit within that environment has another. Yet even if one did succeed in capturing the gravity number of one particular rabbit, one would still miss the deeper point that rabbit as such is not that one rabbit at all. For that rabbit will soon die, but rabbit as such is the genus which will live on long after any one rabbit completes its own life cycle of reproducing, which of course it does in order to perpetuate the species beyond itself rather than itself. Although one rabbit has a gravity number, the genus of rabbit really does not. Yet the greater irony here is that in its ultra-logical quest to understand life through the quantification of measure, reason missed the point that the genus rabbit itself is the real measure of the life force. A paragraph 292, reason now explicitly posits species as the determinate universal, which observation had been seeking out all this time. In many ways, though, reason forgets the earlier phase of understanding force in the third section of the book by treating the species as essentially the same thing. Just as the forces of electricity vanish into one another, any given rabbit dies after completing its life cycle and then vanishes into the species itself, which unites the universal genus with the self-transcending evanescent single rabbit. Observing reason, though, still misses its own point by cataloging the genus itself as just another number in a much broader taxonomy. This attempt to catalog all the species of the Earth into a single, rigidly ordered biological system eventually leads reason to realize that the individuation of each species into actuality is determined ultimately by the Earth itself. The Earth is the universal individual, and therefore the real object of observing reason we have been seeking out thus far. This universal individual of the Earth is revealed to embody also the negativity which restricts how any given species might be instantiated within its environment. For, as Hegel says himself, the genus suffers the violence from the universal individual, the Earth, which, as the universal negativity, forces the action of the genus to be a quite restricted affair, which is permitted to be carried on only inside of those powerful elements, and which is interrupted, incomplete, and curtailed on all sides by their unchecked violence. In other words, just as reason discovers life as a certain evolution, which occurs within ecological limitations. It recognizes that those ecological limitations are themselves simply the violent constraints imposed by the Earth itself, such as the violent constraints of climate and other harsh conditions which lie beyond its control. By paragraph 295, this discovery of ecologically determined evolution only ends up trapping observing reason yet again in the deadlock of finding that any attempt to catalog this proliferation of evolutionary genuses only results in an ordered set of, once again, dead numbers which negate the notion of life which they were supposed to capture. This is, in other words, a critique of the very idea of capturing life within the kind of scientific methodology which observing reason has been trying to use throughout the entirety of this section. By paragraph 297, the resulting logical syllogism lacks any middle term and causes the genus to fall into the individuals in a way that makes any attempt to derive laws from what are actually just mere opinions, makes that structurally impossible. Because observing reason now cannot observe nature, it can only mean it. In the German play on words of mining it, in which case it is only mine. But then, again, such a mere opinion of mine is not a law at all. So observing reason is now forced to return to self-consciousness through investigating the formal laws of its own thought through the study of logic, as we will see in the next section. So, thank you once again for watching. I look forward to continuing this discussion with you.